Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chonsom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Wednesday, the 2nd of September. States further ease COVID-19 restrictions in India, cases surpass 3.7 million mark. Former Afghan President Karzai supports Abdullah's stance on council structure. And coronavirus infection in Nepal enters community transmission phase. And now for all the details. Several states have further eased COVID-19 restrictions as part of Unlock Phase 4 in India in an effort to avert more serious economic damage. This comes as the country's COVID-19 tally crossed the 3.7 million mark on Wednesday, with a single-day spike of over 78,000 cases in the past 24 hours.
As the Unlock Phase 4 commenced in India from 1st of September, several states have further eased the coronavirus-induced restrictions on the movement of people and functioning of commercial establishments like bars and hotels with mandatory COVID-19 precautions. This comes as India's COVID-19 tally crossed well over the 3.7 million mark on Wednesday, with a single-day spike of 78,357 cases in the past 24 hours. And the death toll reached 66,333, while recoveries have also surged to 2.8 million. State-run bus services resumed in Chennai city of Southern Tamil Nadu state, while places of worship, parks, shopping malls, hotels and clubs also reopened across the state and neighbouring Karnataka's Bengaluru city after over 5 months of COVID-19 lockdown. As per guidelines, educational institutions will, however, remain closed till 30th of September, with some relaxations for students of classes 9th to 12th. With the resumption of boating in the lakes of Uttarakhand state, the tourism industry in Nainital city began to come back to life yet again on Wednesday.
अब धीरे-धीरे देखते हैं जैसे-जैसे सरकार अपनी गाइडलाइन में थोड़ा सा और छूट देती है कस्टमर का आना रहता है हम इसी मूड में हैं कस्टमर यहां पर आए और अक्टूबर के समय हमारा थोड़ा सा ठीक-ठाक सीजन रहेगा
Meanwhile, the joint entrance exam for admission to top engineering colleges in India took place for the second day across the country on Wednesday while adhering to COVID-19 protocols.
Tensions between India and China have renewed as New Delhi on Tuesday informed Beijing has yet again attempted a provocative action on August 31st, just as military-level talks were being held to resolve the earlier August 29 and 30 intrusion at the southern bank of Pangong So Lake in Ladakh. China has maintained it did not provoke any such conflict at the border.
India on Tuesday accused China of attempting yet another provocative action on August 31st, just as military-level talks were being held to resolve the earlier August 29th and 30th intrusion at the southern bank of Pangong So Lake in Ladakh. Spokesperson of India's Foreign Ministry Anurag Srivastav, issuing a statement on Tuesday evening, said, On 31st August, even as the ground commanders of the two sides were in discussions to de-escalate the situation, the Chinese troops again engaged in provocative action. The spokesperson asserted, due to the timely defensive action, the Indian side was able to prevent these attempts to unilaterally alter the status quo. China has maintained it did not provoke any such conflict at the border.
चीन ने तीसरा अटेम्प्ट किया पैंगोंग सो के दक्षिणी दिशा में वहाँ पे ब्लैक टॉप को वो उसने कैप्चर करने की पूरी प्लान बनाई थी देखिए चीन का स्ट्रेटजिक एम क्या है चीन का स्ट्रेटजिक एम था कि जो सेंटर ऑफ ग्रेविटी है वो पैंगोंग सो के उत्तरी साइड से लेके दक्षिणी साइड में शिफ्ट कर दो और यदि वो ब्लैक टॉप हिल को कैप्चर करने में सफल हो जाता तो वो पूरी तरह से इंडियन पोस्ट जितने भी हैं उसको डोमिनेट करता।
The new developments have renewed tensions in Ladakh, where 20 Indian soldiers and unverified number of Chinese troops were killed during a violent face-off on June 15th after hours of hand-to-hand fight in Galwan Valley.
Moving on, load shedding and high electricity bills have continued to trigger unrest among the people of Pakistan-administered Kashmir. Residents find it ironic that despite housing major hydropower plants, the illegally occupied region is unable to fulfill its minimum demand of power supply.
Unscheduled and long hours of load shedding has continued to hit normal life in the illegally occupied region of Pakistan-administered Kashmir. Locals say it is ironic that even after generating more than 1,000 megawatts through hydropower projects in the region, the residents suffer 16 to 18 hours of power outages on a daily basis. And over that, heavy billing is also a vital issue that has never been addressed by the successive Pakistani governments that control the Water and Power Development Authority. Residents call it an injustice done to them at the hands of administrators.
यहाँ बिजली का निज़ाम जो है वो एक तो गैर एलानिया लोड शेडिंग ज़्यादा हो जाती है और दूसरा ये है कि बिजली के नरखों में आए रोज़ इजाफा होता है और एक शहरी जो मुलाजम है 20-25 हज़ार रुपये का उसको 5-6 हज़ार रुपया बिजली का बिल जब आ जाता है तो वो फिर वो इतना अफोर्ड नहीं कर सकता। तो इसलिए एक तो बिजली का निज़ाम वफाकी हुकूमत के पास है तो वहाँ से जो rates aate hain aaye roz ispe izafa ho jata hai bataye bagair izafa ho jata hai.
Recently a massive protest rally was also taken out by locals in the region against frequent load shedding in the illegally occupied region. The protesters demanded that the electricity produced from the resources of Pakistan administered Kashmir should be given to them only and not to Pakistani provinces.
In news from Afghanistan, former Afghan President Hamid Karzai has said that he welcomes Abdullah Abdullah's stance on selecting the members of the High Council for National Reconciliation after consultation with political leaders, elders and civil society organizations. The council is a body tasked with leading peace negotiations with the Taliban.
Former Afghan President Hamid Karzai on Tuesday welcomed Abdullah Abdullah's stance on selecting the members of the High Council for National Reconciliation, a body tasked with leading peace negotiations with the Taliban after consultation with political leaders, elders and civil society organizations. Taking to Twitter, Hamid Karzai said, "I am confident that comprehensive consultations with all sections of the society will lead to the establishment of an inclusive and credible National Peace Council." Karzai has earlier rejected President Ashraf Ghani's decree, making him a member of the council, saying he will not be part of any government structure, but vowed his support and efforts for the peace process as a citizen. On Monday, Abdullah also stated his opposition to Ghani's list of council members, saying that according to the political agreement, it is the authority of the head of the council to appoint its members. The High Council for National Reconciliation is to oversee a 21-member negotiating team appointed by Ghani in March to conduct face-to-face talks with the Taliban. The talks are part of an agreement reached between the Taliban and the United States in February in an effort to end nearly 19 years of war in Afghanistan.
Moving on to news from Nepal. The rising number of coronavirus cases in Nepal has thrown government authorities into a tizzy. The health ministry has said that with growing cases in the Himalayan nation, 12 districts in the country have entered the phase of community transmission.
With growing cases of COVID-19 in Nepal, 12 districts in the country have entered the phase of community transmission, reported Nepal's health ministry. In a press briefing on Tuesday, Nepal's public health advisor Dr. Suresh Tiwari said that the Himalayan nation has entered community transmission in 12 districts, including its capital, Kathmandu. The districts under the community transmission include Morang Sunsari, Danusha, Mohatari, Parsa, Bara, Rautahat, Sarlahi, Kathmandu, Lalitpur, Chitwan and Rupandehi.
ने 12 वटा जिल्लामा जम्मा जम्मी संक्रमित संख्याको हिसाब गर्दाखेरि 73% संक्रमितहरु हुनुहुन्छ त्यसले गर्दाखेरि पनि अब के संकेत गरिराछ भन्दा यो पकेटमा यो 12 वटा यो आउटब्रेक भएको पकेट एरियामा यसलाई हटस्पट पनि भनिन्छ यो एरियामा चाहिँ केन्द्रित भएको देखिएको हुँदा हामी चाहिँ अब यो एरियामा समुदाय संक्रमण भयो भन्ने बिन्दुमा पुगेका छौ
Meanwhile, Nepal opened its skies for international flights starting Tuesday, allowing limited regular passenger and chartered flights months after it was suspended from March 22nd as part of government's bid to curb the spread of COVID-19. With newly reported cases, Nepal's COVID-19 count on Wednesday reached 40,529, including active and fatality cases.
The Tibetan government in exile in India's northern hill town of Dharamsala marked the 60th Democracy Day on Wednesday. This day marks the anniversary of the establishment of the democratic system of the Tibetan people living in exile in India.
The Tibetan government in exile celebrated its 60th Democracy Day in India's northern hill town of Dharamsala on Wednesday. Tibetans, including senior functionaries, Buddhist monks, took part on the occasion. On this very day in 1960, the first elected representative of the Tibetan Parliament in exile took their oaths and inaugurated the Tibetan democratic system. Speaking on the occasion, Sekyong Lobsang Sangye, head of the Central Tibetan Administration, paid homage to Tibetan spiritual leader, the 14th Dalai Lama, pioneer of the Tibetan democracy, and extended warm greetings to Tibetans in and outside Tibet and supporters around the world. He refuted Chinese President Xi Jinping's recent proposed policy directions on Tibet and called it misguided and unrealistic.
So they want to misuse Buddhism to promote further the goals of Communist Party, which is absolutely unacceptable to us. And this kind of hardline policies will never work.
India is home to almost 100,000 Tibetans. Exiled Tibetan spiritual leader, the Dalai Lama has lived in the country since fleeing a failed uprising against Chinese rule of his homeland in 1959. While Beijing considers him a violent separatist, Dalai Lama says he is merely seeking greater autonomy for his Himalayan homeland.
Hindus in parts of northern India on Wednesday gathered at the banks of River Ganges and performed special prayers for salvation of their ancestors on the first day of Pitru Paksh, an annual fortnight-long ritual. During Pitru Paksh, Hindus do not organize any auspicious events like weddings or inking of business deals nor buy new clothes or products.
Hindus took a dip in the holy river Ganges and performed other rituals on Wednesday in parts of northern India, marking the start of Pitru Paksha, an annual four-night ritual for the salvation of the souls of ancestors. Guided by priests, people in Kanpur city of Uttar Pradesh state were seen performing the ritual of offering food to ancestors on the banks of river Ganges. As per the Hindu calendar, Pitru Paksha usually falls in the month of September or October. As part of the ritual, the priests narrate the relevance of offering the pindan or charity, saying it is dedicated to ancestors.
इसमें पितरों की श्राद्ध होती है, तर्पण होता है 15 दिन और उनके पितर तृप्त होते हैं। आज के दिए गए दान इस अष्टमी के महीने में दिए गए दान को पितर आपके पाते हैं। वही पुत्र को आशीर्वाद प्रदान करते हैं।
In Prayagraj city, the usual hustle-bustle at the banks of River Ganges was missing on the occasion due to coronavirus restrictions. But few people were seen remembering their ancestors and doing charity in their names. Certain devotees even got their heads tortioned on the occasion as a mark of respect for the departed souls. According to the scriptures, the souls of those ancestors who have not yet achieved salvation gain peace during Pitru Paksha prayers.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter at AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.